Behind home plate, we bringing it to them all day. You know what's up, welcome to Birdland. Win or lose, we bringing it to you always. You know what's up, welcome to Birdland. Orange or black, we rebuild the pack. No matter where we at, you know we coming back. Section 336, we on this, so tune in. You know what's up, welcome to Birdland. Yeah, yeah, welcome to Birdland. You know what's up, welcome to Birdland. Birdland. Now, here come the boys from Section 336.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Baltimore sports fans of all ages, welcome to Section 336, Next Generation of Baltimore Sports Talk. I'm your endearing, stuttering host, Matt Sroka. As always, I'm joined by the button lover, Josh Sroka.
Hey, Matt, that's a little fast forward to the intro. Is that just how we're going to do the whole show, like the Micro Machine Man or something now?
Well, I tell you what, we have actual baseball to talk about for the first time in a while. There's a lot to get to. We have a lot to talk about. So I thought, instead of having the viewer turn us on 1.5 speed, we'll just do the whole podcast in 1.5 speed for the listener.
Okay, so this is kind of like, just like baseball is speeding up with the pitch clock, we've decided we're going to speed up our podcast as well.
Yes, if that means we can get done in 40 minutes, I'm all for it. Shorten the time of this thing.
Yeah, right, right. We're going to record it super fast, and then we'll slow it down and put it out for the podcaster. That's record, right. In 35 minutes, you listen, and it takes an hour and five.
You can listen at your own pace. That's the beauty. Do you wish, Josh, with baseball, you could have that option? Like, would you watch it at 1.5 speed if you could?
No. In fact, I think it's bad to listen to podcasts at 1.5 speed.
No, but I'm saying the baseball game.
No, because see, you do this crap. I don't do this. I like the games live at the pace of baseball. I like the pace of baseball. You like to go in and do like the game catch up where it speeds up to the moment.
That's not true. The highlights. First of all, here's the thing. I would prefer to watch it live, but life gets in the way. And I just skip commercials. That's all I do. I just skip the commercials.
Okay. All right. You don't do just a game recap feature or whatever on there?
No. I don't. No. Though that's a good feature, and SAS always does that. No, I watch all the game. Now, last year, listen, I sometimes, depending on who was pitching, I'd give a plus 30 between pitches because it takes so long between pitches. Well, I can't do that anymore.
All right. I love the pitch clock, or I guess it's officially called the pitch timer because it's not a clock. It goes backwards. I don't know. There's some controversy on the internet about it.
I don't know. They get the countdown.
Yeah. So I like the pitch clock. I love it watching so far what I've seen this weekend. I'll tell you what, I'm a little concerned come Thursday because there's certain pitchers, especially for the Yankees, that I know I've got time to run to the bathroom. And I don't want to be like everyone in the stadium and go in between innings because then you got to wait in the line. But I know baseball well enough that I can figure out the pace of the pitcher and know, oh, I got time to run to the bathroom and I'll be back and not miss a thing.
Yeah.
And I don't get that anymore.
Josh, forget that. What about concession lines? You can't, if you're going to get your little chicken fingers, you're going to miss three innings.
You better be bringing some mangoes to the game on Thursday.
Mangoes, peanut butter sandwiches. I'm going to be
sad. You're right. The concessions on opening day, when this stadium is packed, one thing we know about Oriole Park is it doesn't matter if it's a sellout. They don't hire any extra concession people.
Yeah. There's long lines if there's 10,000 people in there.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to bring cash so I can buy from the beer vendor. Because I'm not going to wait in a line. I got to go through the guy that comes around with the bucket.
Is that still cash only, the beer vendor guy?
I don't know. I just assume so. I'm not going to pass my credit card down the aisle.
Well, Josh, I had to get Silas had a field trip, but they needed $25. Don't ask me where they're going for a $25 field trip. I don't even want to get into that. I discovered, Emily said, how about you're out? How about you get some cash? I realized I really have no idea how to get cash now. I don't know how.
I'm with you.
I have a debit card. I don't know my PIN. I don't know if I ever even set up a PIN.
Do you know how I give Emma her chore money and birthday money and she went on a trip, graduation money and all this?
I would guess Venmo.
I Venmo her. Yeah. I don't. If there's cash in the house, it's because someone gave it to me for some reason.
I had to borrow Emily's debit card, and she had to tell me her PIN to get cash. Or I have no way to access cash myself.
We got cash out of the ATM before we went on the cruise in December. We still have cash in the house because we have that pile from December where when we need a couple dollars for a kid or something, we go there. You know, Tooth Fairy comes or something, we go into that little cash pile because we don't get cash out of the bank. Yeah, we're becoming a cashless society.
Yeah.
And hey, did you see? Speaking of cashless and concessions,
okay.
There's a new concession stand at Oriole Park at Camden Yards where you go in, you scan your credit card, and the door opens for you. And then you take whatever you want and walk out, and the cameras see what you take and bill your credit card.
Oh, it's like an airport thing. They have these at the airport.
Yo, you've been? I've never seen these before.
I've seen them at airports. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's one of those things where, like, you take it all and the cameras just record and charge you.
Yeah. I've never been in there because the whole thing freaked me out too much. But
yeah. It's totally him.
Stuff, but yeah.
But it's a way better thing to help with that concession line as long as, I don't know, maybe. Because the other problem I'm worried about is if it becomes like self-checkout. Because there's self-checkout, you can go really fast, or you get stuck behind an idiot and it's really slow.
Well, remember last year too, they had a whole, like, the credit card machine stopped working. So how are you going to have credit cards only and then all the credit card machines stop working?
That can't happen. Oh, that's a good point. Yeah. I don't think the beer vendors must not take cash because I think Camden Yards is a cashless facility now.
Yeah.
So,
Jay Gibbons, who said we're a bunch of old men. We don't even do cash anymore.
I'll tell you this. Opening day pregame, if you want to come outside to the block party over by WBAL, Orioles Radio Network, and come buy a Birdland Sports shirt pregame, no cash. Only taking card.
You don't have change for a 50 over there.
Exactly. I will take your cash, but I ain't giving you any change. If you have cash, you better have exact cash, because I'm not taking any change.
Yeah.
And when you give me all that cash, it's just gonna come home and go in that cash drawer upstairs because I don't know how to put cash in a bank. How does that work?
I don't. Unless you can take a picture of it with your phone. And it goes right to your bank account like a check. If you can't do that with the cash, not sure how to do it.
My bank doesn't even have a physical building. At least not one around here.
Yeah.
So it's like,
is it called Silicon Valley Bank? There's a reason you don't have a physical building in one of those.
No, it's not. But either way, I still don't have a bank. So that's a good point. If you pay me with cash, then that's going to go in the drawer somewhere. So yeah. Cards.
I
mean,
I was searching the couch cushions for I searched couch cushions for change, like I'm a kid in our old house, Josh, where Dad would sit and just drop change wherever he went. Like, there's no this idea of change in couches is not really a thing. It's just a thing we grew up with.
Yes,
but there's no I don't know if I've ever found a coin, in my couch.
No, but
yeah,
good point. We're going to be at Dad's this week, next weekend.
Yeah, get those
check coins. The couch cushions, because I guarantee he's still dropping cash.
Yeah, because Faye and Silas went to Sunday school, and they made in Sunday school little homemade piggy banks. And then they told these diabolical church leaders, told the kids to take them home, fill up their little piggy banks, then bring it back to church and give it to the church. I thought that was pretty diabolical of them.
I think it's time to write a lot of...
obsessed with collecting all their money to give back to the church.
Yeah, I think a little. It's time for a little IOU, little notes.
Yeah, put some IOUs in there.
Some IOUs.
It's as good as cash.
All right. When you go to, I assume you tithe.
Yes.
Do you use a credit card to tithe?
I set it up automatically on the website, so it just takes right out of my bank account.
All right, I do the same thing.
Yeah,
but I'm jumping between churches because I haven't settled on a church yet. So it's not been automatic, but I text a little number and then it says to charge, and I charge my, not credit card, but bank card.
Yeah.
Because again, these are all places where you used to have a cash. There was something came up where I needed a check, and I don't have a checkbook either. So I had to order a check from the grocery store.
Yeah. I don't even
know. Money order. That's what it is.
Yeah. Money order. Yeah, we have a thing of checks. I don't know if checks expire because they're probably from the 1990s, but we still have that checkbook there.
Yeah.
So you know what I'm really bad at? And then we are going to get to opening day. There's so much sports to talk about. I'm sorry.
Wait.
Listeners.
Right.
Emily and I, you know, I shared the other day about Emily was mad at me about the pastry.
Yes.
I'm
team Emily there.
Yeah, I did something even. Now, I think I'm in the right there. If I don't want pastry, I shouldn't be forced to eat a pastry. But I did something, and I deserve the ire of Emily for this time. This was dumb. Josh, speaking of just putting things in like change and stuff, yeah. I don't have change, but like I am obsessed with if I get anything, a piece of paper, anything else, Emily tells me to put it away, it goes in my pocket. My pocket is a human – I'm a human filing cabinet for all papers.
Okay.
I just put them in different pockets.
All right. But then don't they go straight into the washing machine?
They do. So I just got a new license plate. I'm now officially a Georgia resident with my license plate. By the way, $1,200 to get a license plate here in Georgia.
Oh, because you register to pay taxes?
Yeah, outrageous. But I got my registration. Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
And then I put it in my pocket, and now it's destroyed because it went through the washing machine.
So do you have a Georgia driver's license now too?
Yeah, I got that right when I moved down, but we just finally got our tags.
Okay. Yeah. Got it. I do wish I had a Maryland driver's license, because apparently Maryland driver's licenses, you can just keep a digital version on your phone.
Oh, really?
And I'm like, that's the last thing I need to get rid of my wallet and go in this, get rid of this stupid thing that doesn't hold money anymore.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I never pay with my phone. I know a lot of people are paying with their phones now. I haven't gotten that far yet.
All right. Well, speaking of dad dropping money all over the place, you want to start about Ryan Mckenna, or you want to start with the first game?
Well, I mean, I think the reference to dad too works also because most predictable text ever from dad, tell your kids to watch the video and use two hands. I mean, I think dads across America were texting their children and screaming at the television, use two hands. Even Jim Palmer said it. Use two hands. It's like dads saying for hundreds of years to kids to use two hands, and major leaguers never use two hands. And for the history of baseball, major leaguers have gotten away with it until this moment. And like all dads celebrated that they could point to this moment where a player should have used two hands.
Right. Our text messages this weekend from dad are definitely like the old man on the internet. Like people accuse us of being the old man yelling at clouds. He texted about using two hands. Then yesterday's ugly loss, he texted, oh, this team looks like a last place team. Today Bradish gets hurt. He texts, oh, the season's really going south. We're four games in.
Yes.
Settle down.
Josh, where are you? And this is kind of Overreact Monday. I tell you what, I am at Overreact.
I want a little sounder for
embracing the Overreaction Monday. Like I'm there with them, actually.
All right, I like the idea of a little overreaction, like our bold predictions. I think we should have an Overreaction Monday segment.
Yeah, like I want to go back and redo all my bold predictions after just seeing a series.
I'll tell you. You want to know what bold predictions looking good after this series? Is my stolen base prediction?
Our stolen base predictions, Josh.
You hopped on that too? All right, we both.
Well, I remember I said Mullins, Gunner, and Mateo combined for 100. That was my.
And I said 50 for Mullins and Mateo.
And my Adley top three MVP is looking pretty good too.
Yeah. No. And let's start. I mean, yeah, we talked pre-show about how we need to make a list where, like, every week we're going over some highlights and lowlights of the week to kind of start our transitions into baseball. So let's go over some of those highlights. Game one, I mean, Adley 5-for-5, putting up nine runs.
And got on base six times with a home run and four RBI. Like, that is one for the history books, Adley Rutschman's opening day. Like, that was a historical opening day. And it's appropriate. Well,
it's something that's never been done before.
Yeah, and it's appropriate that, you know, this team is built around Adley Rutschman, and he seems like the kind of player who, in big spots, kind of steps up, right? I mean, if he gets a fly ball in the bottom of the ninth with a one-run lead, he's not dropping that fly ball. Like, he's the guy. I'm sorry, we're going to stop making Ryan Mckenna.
Mckenna's caught 999 out of 1,000 balls.
Yeah, but to me, Adley's a guy who's kind of steps up in that big moment. It's perfect. It was a perfect start of the season that he would kind of go off and kind of make a statement saying, yeah, I'm the face of this franchise.
I'm
Adley Rutschman, and I'm an MVP. Like, let's go.
His first at-bat was a home run. Talk about saying, hey, I'm here.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, so a good opening day. You couldn't ask for a better start. I mean, I know the pitching almost fell apart there at the end and made it way too stressful. Yeah. Welcome to baseball with the Orioles. But, you know, great offensive performance all weekend, really, and a good win opening day.
Right, and Saturday we got to see Austin Hayes go get five hits.
Yep, 5 for 5 as well. So yeah, taking turns, who goes 5 for 5?
It was fun to see Austin Hayes on that fifth hit that was a double, and see how much he really wanted that triple. He really wanted to get that cycle, and it was fun to see
him laughing about it with the dugout,
laughing about it on second base. Like, no, and we talk a lot about how. In big moments, like, do the guys really know what's going on, or just the fans focused on it? He knew, and everyone on that in that dugout knew he needed a triple for the cycle.
Yeah, and that was cool.
It was cool to see the fun.
They interviewed his wife, and I guess he just his son. I forget the son's name. Was recently born, and he was up there. He's one. I think he was celebrating his 1 year old birthday.
Right.
And he said he was going to hit a home run for him, and he turned to having a 5 for 5 amazing game.
Yeah.
And so that was pretty cool to see. So
yeah.
A tough way to end that game, because no one's talking about Austin Hayes, because we were just talking about Ryan Mckenna, but there were a lot of good things in the game as well.
Yeah. And unfortunately for Ryan Mckenna, it happened at the end of the game and a home run was hit right after it. Because if that happened in the third inning, no big deal.
It would never happen in the third inning though.
Because Mckenna won't be out there.
My argument is this. I was on board with everybody else. Let's ship Ryan Mckenna, not just out of the majors, but let's ship him out of the country. I was on board with everybody else. But the thing is, when Ryan Mckenna dropped that ball, I was furious. I was mad. I was in disbelief. But I also, that was one of the most relatable things I've ever seen. I'm the kind of guy who, in high pressure situations, I choke all the time. I remember teaching one of my first years of teaching when we had that earthquake in Maryland, and I had no idea what to do. I panicked and choked. I didn't even know where the exits were. I was like, I don't know what to do.
Big difference. You had never been in an earthquake before. We hadn't had one in our lifetime in Maryland before. Ryan Mckenna has caught 1,000 balls.
I agree, Josh. But even if a little dribbler is hitting me at shortstop and the game's on the line, I guarantee I'm throwing that ball 5 feet over your head, because I choke up in key situations. I think for Ryan Mckenna, it was a total choke job. I don't think it was about dropping. I think it was about the pressure of the moment, and he lost focus in the pressure of the moment.
I don't think it was a choke job.
You think it was just random?
I think it was just random. I think we see random things happen all the time. And it was random. And unfortunately, like, the home run was hit afterwards, so the game was lost. And I think the bigger story from that game is that we were up 7-1 and we blew that lead. To me, that's way bigger than Ryan Mckenna dropping a ball.
Yeah, but if Ryan Mckenna catches a ball that everyone catches all the time, we win.
I agree.
It changes everything.
But if Felix Bautista struck out Duvall, we win.
Fine. But no one was getting Duvall out because he was crazy against us. That's our new guy. I mean, every year there's someone new. This year it's Duvall is going to be the guy that just kills us all year. But it's so crazy how that happens, right? One dropped ball and the whole weekend just feels different, right? Like, we'd be feeling really good about taking 2 out of 3 in Boston. And now I'm with Dad. Like, I'm ready to throw in the towel in the season. I'm kind of done.
I don't know. My takeaway was more of, our offense was exciting all weekend. We put up a bunch of runs. I mean, what was it? 9 runs? 8 or 9 runs, and then 5 runs? We put up a bunch of runs. We stole a bunch of bases.
Yeah, if you look at the offense category, we are number one in all of baseball in OPS, right? Mm-hmm. That's the big stat on base, punch, slugging. We're at the top in steals. We're near the top three in pretty much every offensive category after the first weekend.
Right.
We're up so there, that's right, why Boston.
When I go out of this first weekend, I get a little concerned about pitching. And even more than get concerned about pitching, I go into that what-if mode. I go in, what if we took a little bit of the $43 million profit we made last year and spent it on a real pitcher?
I think it was like $65
million. $65 million. What if we spent enough of it so we only made $43 to get a real pitcher? That's what my takeaway was. What if we spent money in pitching? This offense is awesome. This offense is on fire. It's putting up runs. What if we spend a little on pitching is my takeaway.
Yeah, because the reality of it is, and I said this at the beginning of the year, at the beginning of our pre-show thing, whatever, it's going to be preseason. It's going to be up to – this season is going to be up to our pitching because I think our hitting is going to be fine.
Yeah.
I talked about the importance of kind of quality starts. I mean, Dean Kramer, 3 innings. Cole Irvin, 4 innings. The only guy that got to 5 innings was Kyle Gibson, and he gave up 4 runs in those 5 innings, so he wasn't that great. Our starting pitchers, ERA of 7.2, 13.5, and ERA of 15. That's, I mean, you're not going to win very many games if you have an ERA over 7, and all our starters right now do.
Right, and that's my point. And the bullpen's not been great either. It's had moments.
Yeah, well, and the bullpen, and listen, we didn't talk about this enough probably, but two of your back end arms, Dylan Tate was one of your best pitchers last year, and then also losing Michael Givens. Those are significant blows in the 7th and 8th innings, and so that's, I don't think we talked about that enough. Also, keep in mind last year we had Jorge Lopez for the first half of the year, so I know our bullpen was a strength last year. But you lose Jorge Lopez because you trade him, which could turn out to be a really bad move if you look at this bullpen for this year when you're trying to win. And then you lose Dylan Tate and Michael Givens with injuries during spring training. And all of a sudden, you have guys like Logan Gillespie getting big innings. You have guys like Mike Bauman, who you're relying on. Brian Baker is now taking on a bigger role. And Brian Baker hasn't pitched well in a long time.
No, hold on. He pitched fine last season. The second half of last season, he was pitching really well.
Our memories are different. I think he struggled at the end of last year.
All right, I'll look up Brian Baker's stats. I thought the second half was when he really shined.
Okay, I could be wrong on that, but I feel like he had his struggles. So, but at any rate, I don't have like if we're looking at the Matt Stroke confidence meter. I have very little confidence in any of our bullpen outside of Cionel Pérez and Felix Bautista. Outside of them, when anyone else is on the mound, I have very little confidence. It's one thing if you're asked, you know, your bullpen's struggling. I feel like every team, there's like this middle relief is kind of struggling, which is why you need pitchers to go, you know, at least into the 6th inning so you can get to the back of your bullpen, which is going to be stronger. But we haven't even been able to get to the back of our bullpen. So we're throwing guys. I mean, Danny, I don't even know how to say his name.
Columbo,
who we just picked up of waivers a couple of days ago, has now pitched in 2 games for us because we just need him to.
Yeah. No, and Brian Baker last year had a 3.49 ERA overall. So not a bad year.
All right.
I'll take that. But this year it's 10 already. But again, small sample size. I get that. But it is. My takeaway, everyone wants to talk about Ryan Mckenna and send down Ryan Mckenna. There's people online calling to fire Brandon Hyde because Ryan Mckenna shouldn't have been in that game. Talk about overreaction Monday. Complain about the pitching. The pitching's a problem, not Ryan Mckenna.
I mean, the interesting thing about Ryan Mckenna is there's two things, and you might disagree with him starting because you like Kyle Stowers, and I get that, whatever.
Right. The interesting thing about started that, though, tonight
is earlier that game, Ryan Mckenna had an amazing diving catch for that game.
Right.
The second interesting thing is, even if Kyle Stowers, you guys aren't ready to hear this, but even if Kyle Stowers would have started that game, in the 9th inning, there's a really good chance that Ryan Mckenna would have gone in to replace Kyle Stowers in the last inning. So I'm just saying, even if Kyle Stowers started, you probably would have been that similar situation.
Yep, Ryan McKenna's our Andy Chavez. He's that late-in defensive replacement.
But, Josh, the question is...
And he showed it off early in the season.
But then why is he starting in an early game in the season if that's what he is?
Because we know managers do this. We know that in the first series, you try to get everyone involved. You try to get everyone off the bench, everyone playing a little.
I guess. I mean, I like to see Bauer in there.
And also, Stowers hasn't shown anything yet.
Okay, Josh, you can send the hate mail just at Josh Sirocco on Twitter. Don't send to me, guys. I didn't say anything bad about Kyle Towers. Just send it to Josh.
Is there a Sunshine fan club?
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people are unhappy, and I'm included. I'm not as vocal about it, but I think Costaris should have played more last year, and I think he should play more this year.
Okay.
Speaking, Josh, of making people mad and about the offense, I think you owe Mr. Mike Elias an apology, because I feel like you poo-pooed the addition of Adam Frazier, and Adam Frazier has one of the best offensive players in baseball through the first weekend. Some could argue he is the best offensive player through the first series in baseball. Josh, would you like to now take this moment to apologize to Mike Elias for poo-pooing the signing of Adam Frazier?
At the moment, Adam Frazier has the best batting average on the team at a .556.
Yep, best OPS as well. Okay.
Yeah, 1.822. Yeah.
Yeah, Adam Frazier. That's probably the best OPS in baseball. It's very possible.
Adam Frazier had a great weekend. Last year, he batted .238 for the season. Last year for the season. A couple years ago,
he made the All-Star team. Just pick your season, Josh.
Hold on. I'm with you. Maybe he did something different this offseason. How many home runs does Adam Frazier have this year?
He has one.
How many did he have last year?
I think three.
He's got one. Last year, he had three.
Yeah.
So, if Adam Frazier plays all season the way he played this weekend, amazing pickup, Mike Elias.
Yeah, it'd be the MVP.
Adam Frazier,
if he bats over .500 for the rest of the year, he'll break a lot of records.
Yeah, if Adam Frazier doesn't hit another home run until July, I don't know what he's doing on this team.
All right.
So
time will tell.
Small sample size. Forget time will tell. Small sample size. Talk to me next. If Adam Frazier still has a high batting average a week from now, then I'm ready to take it back. I'll give you a week.
All right. We'll revisit Adam Frazier's numbers in a week. Josh, what are your thoughts on stolen bases? That first game was wild. The stupid Red Sox catcher, that first game, we stole it five times.
Trying.
He didn't even throw it down at all.
Nah.
He didn't even try.
I love it. Love it. Everything about the – I love the pitch clock. I love the stolen bases. I love baseball, and I love all the changes they made this year. It's bringing small ball and excitement back to baseball. The fact that
even if the first two Orioles games were still over 3 hours, so I guess pace of play hasn't affected.
No, it has.
I haven't made it to the Orioles yet.
No, I don't. Was it over 3 hours?
First two games over 3 hours.
What was our average in Boston last year? Boston's a slow team.
Well, yeah, and there was a ton of runs scored.
Yeah,
and it was high scoring. Bullpen moves.
Right.
So that's why. And the last game was .244.
I'll tell you.
If you look at the numbers, batting average is up across the league. Stolen bases are up across the league. Pace. The time is down by like 25 minutes across the league. It's all good stuff.
It's all good. And I don't feel rushed. I don't feel like I'm missing anything watching at home. But I also feel like I'm not looking at my phone. Like I'm paying attention to the game, which is all good things.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there were some people who criticized. And listen, I'm not knocking these people criticized because you just didn't know. But some people criticized that, like Jim Palmer and Kevin Brown, there's going to be no room for storytelling when the game is being played this fast. But I still feel like there's time for like they're still telling stories.
Yeah.
Kevin Brown's still asking questions. They're still making jokes.
Welcome to Breezeline, where you'll say ta-ta, T-Mobile, because we have 99.9% network reliability and they don't. That's right. Time, weather, or even streaming in a basement won't affect our superior service. That's because we have real internet backed by our fiber-powered network. And T-Mobile? Well, they just have a 5G cellular network. So for a limited time, find your perfect speed with prices starting at $19.99 a month for 24 months. Terms and conditions apply. Go to breezeline.com to learn more.
You're still talking throughout the at-bats. You're not. So right. I don't see at all that interfering.
And you got to remember the announcers are getting used to the pace as well. So give them a week, and then it's going to be all awesome.
I think I missed a couple hits because they were showing a highlight of the previous play, and the next guy, But there was a hit.
They'll get used to that.
I missed a couple of hits, Josh.
All right. As we're going through some highlights from the weekend, what's the point of instant replay? Let's just get rid of instant replay in baseball. It does. If you cannot get it right on instant replay, then there's no point in having instant replay.
Yeah, especially get that rid of instant. Hit his knuckles. It's weird. Yeah,
get rid of instant replay, and just go. And we all accept that baseball is a human judged game. But if you're going to have instant replay, you need to get it correct. And I saw other people complaining that it wasn't just the Orioles. Other teams were having instant replay issues as well. And I know I'm all orange Kool-Aid drinker thinking replay is screwing the Orioles all the time. But yeah, that ball, we've watched that video over and over again. That ball never touched the guy. It hit the bat.
It didn't touch him at all. And what was it? There was another play where a guy was called out or safe. I forget the other play that was like, another questionable replay here. So I agree. Over the weekend, the replay wasn't kind to the Orioles.
Did they replay?
I'm not with you. I don't think we should get rid of replay, but you wish they would do a better job of making the right calls.
Right. I don't know. Was it Adley's slide in the second?
Did that one go to replay?
That went to replay.
There was several that were like close that I thought should be replayed, but they weren't. And then... Right. Yeah, it was maybe Adley's slide, maybe. That
I didn't understand replay. Sending Adley's slide to replay because that second baseman had already dropped the ball on transfer like two other plays before that.
It was a slide into third, I thought, where the guy like tagged up in his armpit or something.
Got it. Yeah. Yep.
But anyway, but I agree with you. Like, you should get the
get
call
rid of
right.
It. Either you have to get it right or get rid of it.
Well, I don't know if I get rid of it, but just get it right.
And especially now, where they changed the rules for replay for the managers, so the managers have less time to call for the replay.
Yeah, that makes it hard too.
Which I like because it speeds it up. But again, you got to get it right. You got to get replay right. Otherwise, it's an embarrassment.
Yeah, I don't really understand why it takes so long too. It seems like...
No, I feel like...
It should be a fast thing.
Yeah. Yeah. So, any other takeaways from this weekend? Everyone loves Adley.
Yeah, I mean, we said it before. I think my overreaction is I'm seriously, seriously, seriously worried about this pitching staff.
Yeah,
about the whole, and not just the starting pitching, this whole pitching staff. I mean, from the bullpen to the starters to, I mean, this year is already off the rocky start because, I mean, if you asked us a month ago, Josh, everyone had Grayson penciled in. All of a sudden, Grayson struggles. And by the way, he just pitched a game at Norfolk, didn't look great in his opening night at Norfolk either. Sorry.
No.
He's not coming up.
And
he's
not
coming up this week, next week, or in 2 weeks. He's not.
No.
He's going to have to put a string of a couple good starts together.
Right.
So you can't rely on Grayson Rodriguez, which I was relying on. And then all of a sudden, if Dean Kramer regresses, if Kyle Gibson's only average, and now Kyle Bradish, and we can get into this, you took a line drive off the leg. If he's out for any amount of time, we have no, I mean, just, we thought maybe this would be a place of depth, our starting pitching. We have no depth and our bullpen is hurting. It's just, I'm really worried. And by the way, Texas, I don't know how today's game's going cause I don't have it turned on, but Texas went gangbusters, won their first three games of their season. And they're right up there in terms of offense with the Orioles.
Yep.
And so I am seriously concerned about our pitching.
No, it's definitely, and it's, we mentioned at the start of the show, we saw Kyle Bradish get hit and get pulled out of the game tonight early. Hopefully it's just a bruise. Hopefully it's all okay. But like, unfortunately, it's not really an issue where it's like, oh, well, let's just bring up Grayson because he did struggle. He pitched four innings and gave up two runs and he walked four guys. That's it. And that was the big thing against him.
Yeah, that's the thing.
This spring was the walk rate.
Yep. He can't locate his pitches. And that's an important thing in pitching.
Yeah. So I think he's not the answer yet. DL Hall had a decent spring, but was kind of late this spring. I don't know if he's an answer up here yet.
Yeah, he's still building up his innings. I mean, the next guy up is going to be Spencer Watkins. That's the next guy up.
Right. I mean, we've got a couple bullpen guys. Vespi looked good for the Tides this weekend. There's some bullpen arms, but I don't know. We need guys that have some depth. So,
yeah, guys who can throw more than one inning. So
DL Hall gets his first start tomorrow night for Norfolk.
Yeah, but again, I don't think he's going to be ready to be caught up for the next start. I think he's going to have several starts down there.
Nope. So hopefully Bradish is just a bruise because we need Bradish.
Yep. I can't believe in spring training, it feels like just yesterday we're talking about, oh, we have too many starters, not enough spots for starters. This is a problem.
I mean, and
I kept on telling people, this stuff will figure, this stuff will work out. Like, we're not going to have too much starting pitching. And shoot, we could use a Nathan Eovaldi right now. Yeah, we could use a Sean Manaea right now. Man.
Right. Because we didn't have too much pitching. The two guys we were most excited about were not ready to be in the rotation.
Yep.
And that's what it comes down to.
Yeah. And listen, DL Hall is not surprising.
And
it's a little surprising that Grayson Rodriguez is not here.
It is.
But also, he's a young pitcher, and this stuff happens, and you have to, as a GM, you have to be prepared for this stuff.
Right.
For injury or just not pitching up to performance.
No, it's why you went and signed Cole Irvin and didn't try to count on Grayson and DL in your line, in your rotation.
Yeah. But it's also why you should have signed.
Yeah. It goes back to the beginning of the podcast. If we would have spent money on pitching, I would feel better about this team right now.
And this is not hindsight's 2020. Like, we were talking about this during the offseason.
Yes.
As guys were getting signed and signed and signed, every week we would come on here and say,
Eovaldi.
Come on, Orioles. Come on.
Yep.
It's your turn. Let's go. We need a top of the rotation arm. If you can't get a one, give me a two or a three. Come on.
Right. Well, they got us two fives.
Yeah, they got us a couple fives. And hey, you pay for what you get. You get what you pay for. That's the saying. Not you pay for what you get. You get what you pay for. I flipped it around.
You're mixing those quotes up a little bit.
Hey, you know, my other, this is getting off the field issues.
Okay.
If you want to go there.
Sure.
My other takeaway from opening weekend is your boy, John Angelos. Remember? You were Team John to start with, Josh. I've always been Team Lou.
Is that how we did the brother? You took Team Lou?
Yeah. You originally were Team John.
That's right.
I was Team Lou. Me and Brady and Lou, where we were fighting for this team.
I can't believe that we didn't talk about this. I totally forgot about this last week. Man, Josh, that guy's an idiot. Will he just shut up?
Stop
doing interviews.
Why does he's everywhere
right now?
He's doing things in 105.7. He was doing Kevin Brown post game interviews on Masson. He's like everywhere. Well, and every time he talks, like, he just says so many dumb things.
And he brings things up. Like, he brought up
I got a clip, Josh. You want to listen to a clip?
Yeah. Let's get a clip.
Okay.
You know, if you send me these clips ahead of time, we can get them loaded into the machine, so it's not you playing them off your phone into a microphone, and we hope everyone can listen and hear them.
Yeah. I was listening to the Buster Only podcast, and they played a clip of him.
Yep.
They being tore him interviewed up by Jason LaCampaca on 105.7.
And Jason LaCampaca's an idiot, so it doesn't take much. You brought this on yourself, Johnny.
Yeah, I like Jason LaCampaca. Can I say that? I like him.
No,
but
all right.
Because he comes on the Tony Kornheiser show, and he's really good on his
podcast. Does he go on there to talk baseball or football?
He talks football.
All right.
Yeah. Anyway, here's comments, you know, me playing him on my phone, much to Josh's annoyance. All right, here we go.
It's difficult for me to understand what that fascination is. So, you know, I don't know that I need to be answering those kinds of questions from the sun. I'm as transparent gets. You don't just measure that on one issue like that. It's just really silly stuff. And I don't see them asking, you know, the Nationals or the Ravens or any of those other teams to open their books.
So I guess is it something that you think is sort of past, or based on what has been said, you still may sort of provide some sort of, I guess, inkling into how the sausage is made?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know many companies that do that look at how the cost is made. The league probably does have some issues. But again, we should be judged on our one loss record. We should be judged on our community impact. Our community impact is huge. 75 million people in 30 years is visitors in downtown Baltimore. Pretty big. And the last thing is, we should be measured by how much we drive all of our profits back into the product on the field.
Will the Orioles try to be proactive in getting an extension?
Hold on, pause there.
Because then he responds to Adley Rutschman being extended. No, we got to listen to that. But first, you can comment on that first part.
All right. You cannot say, I don't even know where to start. He says, judge us on how much money we make, we put back into the organization. We just got the report that you made $64 million profit.
No, not the profit, among the people. Josh, no, you're concerned about money.
No. He said about the money.
He's concerned about humans, about people.
All right, right.
Okay?
But no, he said that you should be judged on the amount of profit you put back into it. And he just, bad timing for that. He said he doesn't know why everyone wants to know how the sausage is made.
Yeah, why is he brought, his business asking he, about
he brought this up. Dan O'Connolly, who I like Dan, did not ask him to open his books. He said, it's MLK Day. I'll open the books next week. He brought that up. Not Connolly, not anyone at the Sun. No one brought that up except for him.
Yeah.
And so, he promised it then, and then he doubled down at spring training and said, we'll do it.
Yeah.
And he didn't try to back off. Mike Elias at least has tried to back walk lift off.
Right.
He realizes how fans talk that. John Angelos doubled down in spring training, and then he goes in here and it's like, I don't know why anyone's talking about this. Of course no one's going to do this.
And I don't think John Angelos needs to apologize for not opening up the books, actually. Like, I don't think he needs to say, I'm not opening up the books, because everybody knew he wasn't going to open up the books. What he needs to apologize for is saying it. That's the thing. Like, we don't care that you're not going to open the books. We knew you weren't going to open the books. We don't care. Just like say, hey, listen, I shouldn't have said that.
If I said, Matt, I'm going to take you out to steak next week. And then I don't take you. And you're not surprised because I live 4 hours away from you.
I'd never expect you to take my steak.
But I told you I was going to. And then when I didn't do it that week, I said, oh, don't worry. I promise I'm coming up. I'm doing it next week. I doubled down. Yeah. It's like, Josh,
if a guy says, I'm going to give you a bunch of PlayStations, and you give him the money, and he doesn't give you a bunch of PlayStations.
It's exactly. It's the PlayStation guy. I don't think we've said his name on here, so I will keep
John
his name
Angelos
out again.
John Angelos is the PlayStation guy. Josh, is it the same person? No, it couldn't be.
I don't – maybe.
He was in Florida.
No, he lives in Nashville.
Yeah, but he was in Florida with spring training.
But you know what? You know what? You will not see John Angelos. You will not see John Angelos go and tell Billy Joel, hey, I'm going to get you a limo and I'm going to sell tickets and have you perform at Camden Yards and then back off and say, I don't know why Billy Joel wants to play in Baltimore.
Yeah. And I don't care about the interview. I really don't care because I don't care what John Angelos says anymore. But Jason LaCompaca, like the appropriate thing after that response is to say what you said. Listen, John, you said you were going to open the books. This is not us saying it, you said it. That's the appropriate follow-up question.
Right. And here's what I don't get.
He missed it.
No, he didn't miss it. He didn't miss it. They want John Angelos. They want to keep a good relationship with the Orioles. They're not the official Orioles radio network. WBAL and 98 Rock is now the Orioles radio network. So 105.7 is trying to stay in their good graces because they could easily say, hey, we're only doing interviews for WBAL for now on.
Right. Which I get, but like... And so this becomes on John Angelos.
No, it becomes a business decision for LaCofora and WJ and 105.7 instead of asking a real legit reporter question.
Right. And Jason LaCofora, like, he calls himself this kind of insider, this reporter.
Right. No, and that's why
it's
I don't like LaCofora.
Me and you, like, I don't know how to interview a dude. I don't know what I'm doing, but like, that's his job. So it just seems.
No, Dan Connolly would have followed up.
Yeah, I don't know. You like Dan Connolly. He's not a friend of the show, so I don't have any strong feelings either way towards Dan.
No, I think he is a friend of the show. Hasn't he been on the show? He's been on the show.
Oh, he has been?
Wasn't he? I think he was on the show a few years ago promoting his 100 ways to be an Oriole fan or whatever.
Oh, if that's true, then I like Dan. Yeah. Fan of the show.
I'm pretty sure he was.
I'm with you, Josh. I'm a fan of Dan.
I remember having conversations
with people who have been on the show.
I remember having conversations with him about being on the show. So I think he was.
Okay. It could have been just something with you too. Like maybe I wasn't there.
It could have been. It could have been without you.
Just a couple of those. You want to listen to Adley comments?
All right. Yeah, let's get to it.
Because Josh, also, this interview was done on opening day after Adley Rutschman went 5 for 5, hit home run. We're all pumped. This is our dude, Adley.
I know.
And then he's asked about an Adley Rutschman extension.
Let's go.
And Josh, there's a million ways to answer this question. even if you have no intention of re-signing Adley, there's a million appropriate ways to answer this question, and here's how he answers it.
Extension done with an Adley Rutschman, a Gunnar Henderson, or one of your young stars?
Baseball is different than all other sports, and the Pittsburgh Pirates owner is always going to take more criticism than the Pittsburgh Steelers owner, because the Steelers are not going to be upset because it's against the rules in football. And in baseball, that's not our system. So it's always going to be tougher. Hardest thing to do, probably, other than hit a curveball as an athlete, is to work out of a smaller mid-market team in an unbalanced system like baseball.
Okay. Can I just say, before we critique it, can I just say the irony of this is it's dripping with irony, because anyone who follows the work of Jason LaConfora and his time on 105.7 covering the Ravens, he's been screaming from the rooftops that this salary cap in the NFL is fake.
Yes.
And there are ways to work around it, and the Ravens are cheap. And he's been screaming that over and over again with this Lamar thing.
Yeah.
Now to have, you know, John Angelos come and say, hey, listen, I can't sign any but guy because, you know, the NFL is fair, but we're not fair. We're in the small system. The irony is not lost on me.
I did a little Google search after this that to rank baseball teams by their city market size. Okay. And it listed the Orioles as 24.
Yeah.
You know who came in as number 26? San Diego Padres.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
And guess what? The San Diego Padres not only signed Manny Machado to a long-term contract twice, they've also built up and brought in other stars around him. Yeah. So don't give me this crap. Winning baseball, don't talk about filling the seats. Don't talk about the amount of people you brought into the city for that then brought money into the city. Because winning baseball makes you more money. It fills up the stadium. It brings more people into the city. Playoff baseball.
It increases the value of your franchise, which is all what's all about.
Yeah. Playoff baseball does good for the entire state. And really good for your pockets.
Yeah, and that, and we know, you made $60 million last year. You don't need to pay all that to Adley. A small percentage of that could go to Adley. You could still make $50 million and pay Adley. Like, you can do both things. And it's funny how he's doing this all the time. John is drawing on teams when it fits his narrative. Oh, like, I don't want to sign players. We're like the Pirates.
Right. He goes.
When you could compare yourself to the Cardinals, another mid-market team, or the Padres. Like, there's other mid-market teams who are able to extend players.
It's not
about.
You don't
need to compare yourself to the worst franchise in baseball.
Right. It's about excuses. Players. It's like if Steve Bisciotti stood up and said, we can't sign Lamar. We're the Redskins. Look at what the Redskins are doing. You can't compare
that word, but yeah,
I get your. Oh, yeah. Sorry, the Washington Commanders.
Yes.
now you threw me off. Totally threw me off with that.
But Josh, isn't that such? Because an easy response could be, and here's to John Angelos' credit. This is something really good I want to say about John Angelos. I watched him on the Masson post game interview.
Yeah.
And I liked that interview. Do you know why I liked that interview? Because Kevin Brown interviewed him, and Kevin Brown didn't ask him any questions about baseball.
Right.
He asked him questions about concerts. If you're going to interview John Angelos, just ask him questions about concerts. That's all he cares about. Baseball is done by Mike Elias. If you're John Angelos, all you should keep on saying is all baseball decisions are run by Mike Elias. You pay the dude enough money. He can be your scapegoat for writing and signing guys. I would refer all questions back to Mike Elias. And if you ask specific questions about Adley, we're going to handle each situation on a case-to-case basis. But Mike Elias handles the baseball operations. That's all you have to say.
Yes.
But he goes in this whole thing justify. He like immediately goes into defense mode. Like defense mode. Well, instead of saying like how much he loves Adley, how great of a contributor Adley is, he just goes immediately into defense mode. It's just the whole attitude is so off-putting. And I can't believe we're talking about this after the opening weekend. Thanks, John.
I can't believe that we're now all Team Lou. All of Baltimore is Team Lou.
Yeah.
The best thing that John Angelos could do is be like his dad. Stay away.
Well,
don't open your mouth.
Well, yeah. I mean, the irony again with that is Peter Angelos is criticized for meddling too much with the team.
And he spent a ton of money.
Right. And now John is like not meddling with the team, but doing too much talking.
Well, and what I don't get is normally like the son that didn't do much to earn his role, that didn't do much to earn anything to earn the team, is the one that goes out and freely spends the money because he didn't do all the hard work to earn it. Where Peter did all the hard work and he spent a lot more to try to make the team win.
Well, on the one hand, that's weird. On the other hand, well, Peter Angelos, I think, cared about winning.
I don't think
John cares.
No, John has a cool concert venue that happens to play baseball games.
And he wants to do this whole renovation thing, turn it like the Battery in Atlanta. Like, that's his interest.
Yeah, his interest is not winning
a World Series.
No, it's not the field. It's everything around the field.
Yeah, which is too bad for fans of the team on the field.
Right. And maybe that was the conflict with Brady Anderson. Maybe Brady Anderson wasn't a spy. Brady Anderson just wanted to win baseball games.
Yeah, maybe he was a hero. And we all drove him out of here like some kind of Benedict Arnold. But he
we didn't drive him. We didn't drive him out of here.
We did nothing, Josh, because all this is out of our hands.
Yeah.
We're just stupid pawns in their big chess game.
I still think Peter Angelos deserves a standing ovation at Camden Yards.
All right. What about Welcome what would back. You do if they showed John on the Jumbotron?
Tar and feather. Josh?
Tar and feather. Yeah. So. All right. Well, that's that. Josh, this coming week, we got Texas. Then we got opening day. We're feeling good here, right? We're still feeling great. Optimistic. All right. All right. Yeah. Good.
I'm feeling great. Gunnar Henderson's warming up. Adley had a great weekend. Austin Hayes had a good weekend. And home
baseball. Our pitching can't get worse.
Kyle Bradish got knocked out today.
Well, I mean, after today, after that, it can't get worse from now. It's got to just go up.
So, I'm thrown off. I am hopeful because, the Rangers came in hot. If we can play well with the Rangers this series, or we went there hot, we got out of the cold weather. No one's taking into account what that cold weather in Boston does for the pitchers. I don't know what it does for Mckenna, but I know it affects the pitchers. And they went from the warm Florida to the cold Boston. The weather in Baltimore is supposed to be really nice this week.
I keep on checking. Is it going to rain? I see a little bit of chance of rain.
I see rain, but I keep seeing numbers in like high 60s and high 70s. And I love that. So that gets me excited. It is the Yankees.
One for Thursday.
Yeah, I mean, the Yankees have been playing well, so that's concerning.
The Yankees are good.
Yeah, but I mean, in order to do anything this year, we're going to have to play well against the Yankees.
And the good news for our pitching is we moved that wall way back.
Right.
That's good news for our pitching.
And who do we host after the Yankees?
I haven't looked. I mean, my whole focus is Ranger. My whole focus really is opening day.
Okay.
So as far as I'm concerned, the season ends after the Yankee series opening day.
All right. After that, we have the Oakland Athletics.
Okay. We'll destroy them.
I hope so. I feel good about that. All right. So this weekend, we'll both be at opening day.
Yep. Josh, when are you getting to Baltimore?
I am driving to Baltimore on Wednesday.
Oh, you're driving. That's right. Yeah. Okay.
Because I have all this stuff I got to bring up for the booth.
Okay.
So you're flying in on Thursday?
Yeah, Thursday. I think I get in around, I don't know, 9:30 or 10.
Okay. All right.
Maybe after that. I think around 10.
Got it. All right. Well, by that time, I will be downtown. I think 10 to 3 is when I've got a booth outside the stadium.
All right.
So people can come
whenever
see
I get
me
the
there.
Stadium, I'll come by.
Yeah, come on down. And then we'll be at the game on Saturday, and we're going to say do a little listener meetup, center field bar, 6 o'clock, like the hour before game time, 6:05 up there.
All right, sounds good.
And then I am not sure. I might go Sunday. You fly back on Sunday, right?
Yeah, we leave at like 6 a.m. on Sunday morning.
Yeah, I might go Sunday, and I believe I'm going on Monday as well. So
how long are you going to be in Maryland for?
I am getting a tour of the White House on Tuesday.
Shoot, Josh. I was thought that we could do that on Friday. Couldn't make it work for Friday?
Good Friday. No tours because Good Friday. So I'm going to do that on Tuesday. And then I believe I'm going to drive back on Wednesday. So I think I'll be in Maryland about a week.
All right,
6 days, 7 days, something like that. So I'll see some friends there, check some things out as well. As well as I work. My job changed, but now I can work remotely like 95% of the time. So I'm going to be working from Maryland.
Yeah, cool. So. All right. Sounds good. I'm pumped for opening day, all the festivities and all of it. It's going to be, I'm excited to get back into Camden Yards.
I'm just glad baseball's back.
Me too.
The turn game's on every night. Oh, can I ask you this? Yep. I pushed this on Twitter, and I was surprised I didn't get enough interaction. Why is opening day always on Thursdays? Wouldn't it make more sense to have opening day on a Wednesday? Thursday's your off day. Then you have a full weekend of baseball and just start it with four-game series?
Yeah, I've never really thought about it before. I mean, I get the off day after opening day.
Right, but an off day Friday sucks.
It does. Yeah, I have no idea.
I don't know why they do it.
I'm sure there's a reason why they start on Thursday, or maybe it's just tradition. I don't know.
It's a good question. It's probably a tradition, but you're screwing with everything else in baseball, so why not mess with this tradition?
Yeah.
So,
I don't know.
I'm sure it's something that I'm sure it's keeping it as a three-game series instead of a four-game series, because my plan, you would do a four-game series because you would play Friday.
Yeah, you don't want to make the travel day after a Saturday game. Yeah.
Right. So,
So keep it the three-game series. Yeah.
Right, but I would think just open up with a four-game series. You're going to play some four-game series during the year. Open up with a four-game, especially since you have a day off. Bring in the same team for four games and have some fun with it. Get a full weekend.
And have some fun with it. All right, I hope...
baseball, celebrate it.
Yeah, I hope baseball's listening. I hope Theo Epstein is hearing this. So. All right, let's get out of here. Anything you want to plug? I mean, of course, you could.
The booth. Come see me.
Check out the booth.
I'm going to have the Gunnar Henderson shirts, the Birds shirts, which is my favorite, that just says the Birds in the wire font.
Yep. I got one of those.
I'm going to have them in a couple of different colors. I'm going to have the 2023 World Series champion.
I got one of those.
Shirts. And I'm going to have the Birds are back shirts, I believe. No, maybe. I don't remember what the fourth shirt is.
Okay.
So I'm gonna
I got
have
that
a selection
2023 before I realized that Brian Baker was our best bullpen arm in 2023.
Yeah.
If I would have known that. I don't know.
Yeah. I'm hoping we play a little better before then, so those shirts will sell.
Yeah.
Because I think they're cool, just simple shirts. So yeah, I'm gonna have all shirts on sale in person for $20. So come by, grab a shirt. Going with $20 because you should have a $20 bill, and I won't have to give you change.
Fair enough. And nice round number. So I like that.
Do that. Continue to follow Birdland Sports on everything and check out that for a whole lot more shirts up on that website.
All right, cool. Yeah, if you're not following us yet, you should be following us on all your social media platforms. The best place is probably Facebook and Twitter. You can follow me on Twitter at Section336. You can follow Josh on Twitter
at Josh Roca.
Thanks for listening, boys and girls. And as always, go O's.
At Lowe's, shop deals on top outdoor power equipment during SpringFest. Save now on the latest in cordless outdoor power with Ego, only at Lowe's. For a limited time only, get $50 off Ego's TouchDrive 21-inch self-propelled lawnmower. And save $20 on select Ego 15 and 16-inch string trimmers. Head to your local Lowe's or visit Lowe's.com and save on all things spring now. Valid through 4/12. Selection varies by location while supplies last.
92% of households that join Peloton early in the year are still active a year later.
Yeah, if you like cycling to EDM.
Not just EDM. Try cycling to Broadway hits, take a scenic hike in Iceland on our treadmill, or row to some 80s jams.
Because I have so much free time.
Whether you have 30 minutes or just 5, Peloton can fit any schedule. 92% stick with it. So can you. Try Peloton tread, row, or bikes risk-free with a 30-day home trial. New members only. Not available in remote locations. See additional terms at onepeloton.com/home-trial.